get it.
Da auf Ross?
Ja.
Ja. Og mikrofonen virker.
Ja.
Da ønsker jeg velkommen til NUG-foredrag. I dag har vi fått med oss Andreas Brau fra Freifunk I Berlin, som skal fortelle oss litt om community networks og hvordan de fungerer I Berlin, som har kommet ganske mye lengre enn det vi har I Norge. Jeg vil for så vidt få lov til å minne om noe vi har I Norge som heter Dugnadsnett, og at dette en utmerket mulighet til å komme I kontakt med oss, så vi kan jobbe litt videre med Dugnadsnett. Jeg vil takke dere for at dere kom. Så hvis det noen spørsmål, så...
How do you want questions, under the, or after?
We can do it when questions yeah. are there.
Then please use the mic if you want to ask a question. We can just hand it around. Det streames. Vi kommer til å sende rundt en deltagerliste, så bare skriv dere på der. Og ikke glem å komme innom etterpå, som vi har en liten sosial happening. Then, Andreas, Andy,
yeah.
Go ahead.
Thank you for your invitation. I'll tell you lots of things about Freifunk, how we build our community networks, what hardware and software we use, and how we manage our communities and how they are built and so on. So let's start. Who am I? I don't know if you told that everything to them because I didn't understand any word. My name is Andreas Breu. I'm from Berlin in Germany. In my real life, I'm a software developer. I am also a board member of Förderverein Freie Netzwerke. That's a non-profit organization in Germany that supports Freifunk networks or other free networks. We try to bring people together. We try to help developing things and so on. And this is one goal of this organization. And me, I'm Freifunker since 2006. I moved to a new flat and I had no internet there. It was in the middle of Germany in Weimar, and I detected a wireless network called WeimarNetz. It's a kind of Freifunk network too in Germany. It's one of the older ones. And so I got in touch with Freifunk because I needed internet. And then I saw the ideas and the vision, and I liked it really. So I started doing more and more with Freifunk. And so today I'm here. Okay, what's the vision of Freifunk? It's not just about internet access or having a cheap wireless network in cities. The vision of Freifunk, this is a quote from our website. The vision of Freifunk is distributing free networks to democratize the communication infrastructure and promoting social structures locally. This is one sentence that tells very good what Freifunk is for. But what does it mean? Freifunk networks are free and open. That means everyone can just use it. They are not encrypted. You don't need any password. You don't need any captive portal or give your telephone number or your name or something else to someone you don't really know. You don't need to ask someone if you want to be part of the network, if you want to extend the network, if you want to work with the network, just meet the local community and go with them and do things, install some routers and so on. This is what Freifunk stands for. Freifunk is also non-commercial. It's just driven by individuals and persons, sometimes also cafes and so on. But we don't want to be an internet service provider. We don't provide any service level agreements. And we just don't guarantee that there will, for example, internet access or the network will work forever. When someone moves away from his flat and takes his router, then there is no Freifunk network at this space anymore, but maybe someone else will install a new router. What we do have is the PICO peering agreement. This is a kind of international agreement or agreement of a lot of international wireless community networks. This agreement basically says we route traffic without any preconditions. So if you get incoming traffic and it should be routed somewhere else, you just take it from the input, do it to the output, and you don't do any censorship. You don't slow down the network because you can, or someone pays you to be faster or something like that. That's also net neutrality. The PICO peering agreement doesn't apply to the internet access itself, because internet access is seen as an additional service. Shared by someone individual, my private DSL line is shared, and when I say, oh, I just like looking Netflix or Amazon Prime videos, I just want to share half of my internet access. You can't expect from someone that he gives everything for free in there, but the network itself should be without any regulations about the traffic. And of course, we don't do any censorship of data, of routes, and so on within the network. So traffic is free, and everyone can use the network for their own traffic. They are only limited by bandwidth of the routers or of the Wi-Fi, maybe by the air, because there are sometimes so many Wi-Fi networks that it won't work out very good with too many networks. And that's a way where Freifunk can help too, to reduce the number of access points. If you place them on strategic places, it's easier to reach the same goal with less routers, for example. Some more vision things. The Freifunk is owned by many individuals, and we are very decentralized in many ways. Because when we have a bunch of owners of a network, no one can come and say, shut down this network, please, we don't like it. He has to go to every single person and say, shut down this access point. So this decentralized structure makes the network stronger against anything from the outside. If someone wants to destroy the network, he needs to talk to a lot of people, or just has to forbid Wi-Fi networks at all, for example. But the decentralization is not only on the software, it's also on the communities and how we work together. On later slides, I'll show you how we work with it. Oh. What are our goals? We try to reduce the digital divide. We have many people who can't afford internet access, who are just tourists in our cities and want to have short internet access to look for emails or contact their families. We sometimes say we give a digital glass of water to others to help them getting connected to the internet, for example. And Freifunk was also very helpful in 2015 and 16 when all the refugees came to Europe, and we had to build very large networks in refugee homes in a very short time. And on this time, it was really helpful that we had so much training on building wireless networks. We also want to build communication alternatives so that there's not only our telecom provider that's building internet infrastructure. In Berlin, for example, there's a backbone ring of Wi-Fi routers on the rooftops of the town, and you can communicate via Wi-Fi, via Freifunk, from one end to the town to the other via this backbone ring, for example. And what we really want to do is transfer knowledge. We don't want to sell routers that where everything is complete and you just put power in and network in and it works. That isn't helpful because no one learns about the network, how the network is built. So we want to transfer knowledge about network security issues and also about internet services, because what we built with Freifunk is just a small internet, because we use all the same technology as the internet itself uses. And so you can build your own web services, you can build your own cloud server or Dropbox server, for example, and use it in Freifunk networks or give it to others. And this is one thing I really like on Freifunk, to learn so much about things, and you can play around with everything. You can play around with the things the internet uses too. And as I already said, in case of an emergency, you will be able to help yourself. For example, when there's no power, we have solar-powered routers now, and even for the refugee projects, we plan some solar-powered stations to just help them to talk to their families or to get information about where they are, what they need, and so on. Yeah. I think this is about our vision and our goals. Now I'll try to make a little trip to our history. The first steps of Freifunk started in 2000 or 2001. At this time it wasn't called Freifunk because the name Freifunk was invented in 2003. These were just free networks. The very first start was in London, I guess. There was a project in 1999 to have a wireless network in London, free wireless network built by volunteers too. And also in Germany, especially in the eastern parts of Germany, we had one special problem. We had very rare DSL lines and internet access, because after the fall of the Berlin Wall, they built the most modern communication network in the world. We had fiber to the home in our houses, but unfortunately these fibers couldn't be used for internet access. So we had problems that on one side of the street you could get DSL access, on the other side of the street you could get nothing. Maybe at modem speed you could get to the internet, but this wasn't so good. And so it started in Berlin, in Leipzig, in Weimar. People started to help themselves and build Wi-Fi routers on their rooftops to connect each other and build networks and share their internet access. For example, in Weimar, where I formerly lived, we had only three or four DSL lines in the inner city, and we had in 2007 we had about 200 nodes all spread over the city. And for this time, this was a really huge network, because Wi-Fi nodes were much more expensive than they are now. I guess they cost three times more than we pay today for Wi-Fi nodes, and they weren't that powerful as we know it today. Yeah, so Freifunk.net, or the name Freifunk, was invented in 2003, and this was also the time when the first version of our website, Freifunk.net, was published on the internet, just to gather all these communities in Germany and have a single point of contact and of presentation of the idea and of the network and so on. So in Berlin, some people met each other and thought about the name and the logo there. You can see this is was invented in Berlin. The logo was designed by Monique, for example, and yeah, since then it grew. Until 2007, I think, because in 2007 DSL became more affordable and you could get connected people didn't see so much sense in having a Freifunk network. From 2012 it began growing again because we had some other problems. It were liability problems because of copyright infringements, and we had some judges in Germany. They said, when you open your network and someone does anything on your network, you're responsible for that. So no one wanted to open his network to others. And so open Wi-Fi was in practice not possible in Germany at this time. And we had a technical hack for this problem. We just built a VPN server infrastructure, and all the internet traffic was directed to this VPN server. So the person who shared the internet access wasn't the last point to the internet. And if someone wanted to send a letter, they should have done it to the VPN providers. And we didn't get any letters from lawyers because I guess they knew about Freifunk and what we do, and so they were feared of having a bad case at the court. Yeah. Okay. What are our current problems now? We have a problem that our vision is in dilution because a lot of people think, Freifunk, that's a thing with internet, and it's cheap, doesn't cost anything, people work for no money and build a perfect Wi-Fi infrastructure, and some people live this, and we have requests by city administrations and tourist offices, please build us this Wi-Fi network. We pay for the hardware, you work. And so this is not what Freifunk is for, because mostly these networks aren't owned by many individuals. They are owned by a city administration or tourist office. And so it doesn't make any sense for Freifunk to do it. We have also a problem of self-exploitation of members, of community members. They work and work and work and do a lot of cool stuff. And sometimes they just drop off because it's too much what they do. They get family, they move away. These are problems, but I guess these problems do have every community of... Yeah. Other problems are our VPN solutions. Sometimes they are really big, actually we don't need them anymore so much because this summer the laws were changed and you can't get made responsible for copyright things anymore. So we try to reduce the VPN solutions, but a lot of people don't trust this new law and they just want to wait how it goes. And so let's see how it's going with this VPN solutions.
Is that legal change?
Is that legal change effectively making the notion common carrier a working notion in Germany? What they refer to in America as common carrier status.
It's just in Germany, and
it is doing for Germany what the common carrier laws do in the US.
I don't think that there is. When we get letters from lawyers, just from the German representatives of these US companies, I guess. Or I didn't get your question.
No, what you're saying has changed in the law.
Yeah.
That now means that you, as a carrier, are not liable for people transmitting copyright works over your network. It's the common carrier exception in US law where.
That's. You are. You're now an internet service provider in an implicit way, and so you can't get made responsible because every other ISP wasn't made responsible for what users did too. Okay, another problem is that some people try to centralize things in Freifunk networks because it makes a lot of things easier, of course, to manage if you have a central institution for some things. And a lot of people just focus on internet access. This is just not what Freifunk stands for. So internet access thing, yes, can be done, but we tell people then just do it, use our software, use our technologies, but just don't call it Freifunk, because that's not Freifunk when you just when you are just a Wi-Fi access provider or a hotspot provider. Okay, we also do a lot of things in politics. I already talked about the liability thing. Last year we also had the radio lockdown directive. This was a European thing. The European Union wanted to force vendors to ensure that their devices just work for the Wi-Fi frequencies they are specified for, but there were always ways to configure it via software, and the vendors should not allow it to configure it via software, or they should prevent it from being updated by another firmware. So that was a big problem for us. I don't know if it's clear now. I don't think so. It's still in progress. This project is driven by the FSFE, and we are working together with a lot of other wireless communities in Europe. And I also put a link at the end of the slide, so you can also see our joint statement we gave with the Radio Lockdown Directive. Another thing is our non-profit status in Germany. A lot of new Freifunk communities don't get a non-profit status if they state we build free networks, because building a network and giving everyone access isn't a non-profit in law. So you can't get this status if you say we do education, we transfer knowledge, we help people. This is all you can get all the non-profit status for, but not for building networks or something like that. And so we fought to change this, but it didn't work, and we have to wait until the elections are over and we can restart this project again. Data retention. I don't know if there is data retention in Norway. Yes? Okay. in Germany, we do have data retention too, but there are some things in the EU, the European Court had a decision last year that this data retention directive can't be or isn't the right thing to do. And in Germany, the German government said, but we'll do it anyway. And now we are waiting for our highest court to decide on it, and they didn't enforce it now. We thought, or some people thought, they had to save to store this data from 1st of July, I guess, was the date. But it isn't enforced now, and so we don't have to store any data right now, but we don't know how it goes on in future with that. And the last thing is censorship. It was a kind of compromise with the liability thing, because the law now says you can't be made liable, but if we can't delete this content and if we can't talk to the provider of this content, you can be enforced by a judge to prevent access to a website or to URLs it's not clear how you can work with it and how we can deal with it. But a judge has to decide about it. This is the good thing, but I don't think it's very good to do censorship at all. But we don't have a long list of URLs or DNS names to censor them. Okay, Freifunk communities. Do you have any questions to this last part? If there are any questions, we can do it afterwards too. Yes, we have right now, I looked in the morning, we have 428 communities in Germany. They are spread all over Germany, and two or three are also in Austria, I guess. And these communities built more than 45,000 Wi-Fi nodes in Germany. All the communities are independent. We can take a look. I might put a link here. Does it work? Ah, yeah. So this is a map of our communities in Germany, where all the communities. I just click, and you can see it's really widespread over Germany. And I don't see the number in, but it's more than 45,000, isn't it? Yes. Yeah, so we have a map, and you can find your closest community, for example, because we have a lot of people asking for, is there a community in my town, or I want to found a new community, where can I found the next community? And so you just enter your city name or your zip code, and you find the closest community to your place. So all the communities are independent. We don't have some top-down model or something. We say you have to make it like this, or you have to use this logo. Every community.
Christian.
Yeah.
Are there any one of the
microphone?
Yeah. Are there any one of the nodes that stand out in any way? Someone that is more special than the other ones.
I'll come on it later.
Okay, cool, cool.
yes, communities are independent, I already said. Every community is free to decide on their own how they want to work, how they want to organize, how they or what software they want to use, and so on. And there's one thing we wrote down about 3 years ago. It's a memorandum of understanding where we wrote down all the visions and goals and what Freifunk stands for. It's a document, 4 or 5 pages. I put a link at the end of the slides so you can read this document. And we put in all our experiences from the last 10 or 15 years of Freifunk. So it's, I think, a really good document on how Freifunk can work in communities. So how does it use a decentralized way? I already said every community can decide on their own. You can do what you want when it's covered by the memorandum of understanding. So of course we use common resources. We have some entities, or a lot of entities in Germany, like the Förderverein Freie Netzwerke, where I'm board member of. There are a lot of other organizations, a lot of communities are connected to the Chaos, to their local Chaos Computer Club. And I just wrote down some examples. There's VFN, Verbund Freie Netzwerke. They provide, for example, a bug tracker for the Freifunk community, an Etherpad or a Mumble server, so we can use these resources if we want to meet other communities, or we have to talk about common things, or just write down protocols. And so it's really useful that they provide these tools to us. There is the Freifunk Rheinland. It's a very big organization. They provide a lot of VPN infrastructure. They provide virtual machines for communities so they can build up their websites or their build servers or other VPN servers or gateways, whatever they need for their community. And the Förderverein Freie Netzwerke, we, for example, provide the website freifunk.net, our Freifunk Wiki. We also have some build servers and other resources every community can share. And of course, we have regular meetings of communities. There are several events, for example, the Wireless Community Weekend. This takes place every May in Berlin. And communities from all over Germany meet there. There are talks, there are workshops, or even people sitting together and developing software because it's much easier face-to-face than to write down an email or a GitHub issue or whatever. In October, or at the end of September, there is the Freifunk Festival in Oldenburg. I'll be there too. And this is just another region because it's sometimes it's complicated for people traveling throughout whole Germany to get to Freifunk events. So we have a lot of events all over Germany. The Freifunk Camp was in August in the south of Germany. And of course, we are guests on a lot of Chaos Communication events, Chaos Communication Congress. We had a big assembly last year. This year, I guess we'll have an assembly too with workshops and talks and so on. So if you are there at the Chaos Communication Congress, you're invited to visit us there. We have also been on the Chaos Communication Camp. We had a big data center there. And this was a great experience being there. And I saw you have been at the SHA 2017. There was a Freifunk Village too. Maybe you have seen these guys.
I have some early registration passes for the CCC camp. So if the anybody's... What?
The Congress?
Yes.
Yes, the Congress.
Yeah. So... Yeah,
yeah, you should use them fast because no one knows how long they sell tickets. So.
Yeah. Talking with Fukami, if you don't
know.
He's only he hides behind the nick, so.
Okay.
I don't know him other than that.
Yeah. Okay. Another thing that helps us with our decentralized way is the Freifunk Community API. It's just an interface where communities provides data. I don't know if you know the Hackerspaces API. This was invented a lot of years ago. And it's just used to, or it's, for example, used to see if a hackerspace is open, if they have events and so on. And we just copied this concept and built the Freifunk API. And communities now can state where they are, how many routers are online, their links to their maps and their feeds. And so at the end, we can get an aggregated news feed. If you visit freifunk.net, you will see on the left side the aggregated Freifunk news feed of all the collected RSS feeds. We have a common community calendar where lot of community events will be in, and of course we will have several map solutions to display the communities, nodes, and so on. And 2 years ago, we also started FLONS.org, stands for Free and Libre Open Networks, I think, where we connect the meta networks. So for example, Freifunk is one member of FLONS, and there's also Ninux in Italia, and WLAN Slovenia is in there, network in Denmark is also part of it, GUIFINET from Spain. So there we just bring together all those big communities and can do the same things with, for example, the aggregated feed or the common calendar. Okay, let's get into networking now. I'm not sure if everyone knows about ad hoc networking, how it works. Nope. Wi-Fi routers have three modes of operation. You all know the access point mode. We use it every day when we connect with our devices. We use the access point mode of this router. Your device is in the client mode, so access point and client only work together. And there's a third mode, it's ad hoc mode. And clients just open up their network, announce an ad hoc network with a special SSID. And if you are on the same channel with your Wi-Fi and you have the same SSID or BSSID, they just connect with each other in this ad hoc mode. And this is the basis of our Freifunk networks to work with, just having routers working in ad hoc mode to connect with each other and building such nice networks there. And what we did, or people did at first, was developing some dynamic route algorithms to find a way from the route from the left side, a router from the left side to the right side, the best way or the cheapest way, and also calculate new ways when some of the ad hoc networks will disappear. So this is what Freifunk makes. It's ad hoc networking and dynamic routing, so it works in a self-organized and decentralized way. Just put in a new router there. If there are other ad hoc network or other Freifunk routers nearby, they just connect and the algorithms do their way. So. We have different scenarios. I'll start with the beginner scenario. It's like I started too. It's just a router in the window. It's the cheapest solution. It's an indoor solution. And if you have enough neighbors in your house or in your street, it's enough to put the router in your window. If you have for example, a balcony or higher buildings, you can use outdoor devices to connect with other devices. Normally, you will have better results because there is no window in between. especially in modern windows, we have more loss of Wi-Fi signal because there is gas in between the glasses, and or some things to protect from the sun, and so also Wi-Fi signals are blocked. Yeah. And so you can buy devices that are made for outdoor use, and they also support power over Ethernet, so you can you only need one Ethernet cable to the outside and can connect your device with power and internet or other network access. And of course, you can talk to your neighbor and he also installs a device and it will just work. These devices also speak ad hoc or do ad hoc networks, so it's the same way with the window routers. And we also have our backbone networks, for example, on steeples or some exposed locations. If you have landmarks or towers or higher buildings, especially in Berlin, it's easy because the town is relatively flat. There are no hills, or it's not like in Oslo. So you have free sight over kilometers, and you can connect. Our longest distance now is about 13 kilometers. So we have a Wi-Fi connection, and this is easy in Berlin, and we have a lot of steeples, and the backbone network is really big in Berlin. Maybe challenging here when you have some other things in your line of sight, then you can't do the magic.
On the other hand, if you've got hills, you can put something on top of the hill.
So. You know, hilly terrain has its upsides as well.
but you need power there. You need access there, and so on. And mostly, it's easier to get power, for example, on buildings.
Well, the building on top of the hill.
Yeah. These backbones connections are normally done by directed antennas. So we have really directed radio from point to point. Sometimes they also don't speak ad hoc net, or they don't do ad hoc networking, but master client mode to just ensure they can reach each other. And those backbones aren't built by individuals or by single persons. Often there are a lot of people planning it, building it, maintaining it. Because this is not easy to do. On some steeples, we have 16 routers, for example. You can't do it on your own. So that's what's done there. Yep.
What kind of hardware do you use on those steeples?
Hmm?
What kind of hardware do you use there? Is it the ordinary hardware, or is it specialized hardware?
It's hardware you can buy on online shops. It's just TP-Link hardware, or from Ubiquiti. They also have very good outdoor hardware, and there we have those nano bridges and nano stations. And it depends it depends on the distance how good the directed antenna has to be. So you have to decide, but it's also it's all hardware you can buy in shops. Yes, it is a dream of us to have to develop our own hardware, so we don't have any restrictions. But this stream didn't come true right now. Okay, some kind of technical history. This is the mother of all routers, I guess, of all Freifunk and Wi-Fi routers. It's also the reason why our firmware or our operating system is still called OpenWRT, because it's a WRT 54GL or something like that. In Berlin, in the C-base, we have such a tower of old WRT routers because we can't use them anymore. They only support B and G networks, and it doesn't work out on modern Wi-Fi networks anymore. But in the very beginning, we started with normal personal computers and Wi-Fi cards. We had some installations under the rooftop. There were just PCs and Wi-Fi cards and an antenna on the top of the roof, because the simple reason is there were no Wi-Fi routers at this moment when we started to play around with it. Some people had such PCM CRA cards for their laptops, so they could play around. I think the first time it was 1999 on the Chaos Communication Camp when they played around with Wi-Fi. And we also had wired connections between houses. There was no dynamic routing because no one developed these algorithms so far. We also had very difficult configurations. You had to go there via Telnet or SSH and hack something in some configuration files to make it work. or compile things on your own again. So it was really difficult in the beginning to make it happen and to convince people to use it. But we had the situation that people wanted to have internet, so they just did it. And yep. Okay, what hardware do we use? This was the question you already asked. It really depends on the scenario. If you want to use indoor hardware or if you want to use it outdoor. If you want to use it indoor, you can decide, do I need a strong processor? Do I need much memory for extra services? Or do I need a USB connection to add a printer or a webcam or sensor networks or something like that? And you also have to decide, should my connection or should my Wi-Fi be directed or should it be omnidirectional? And so you can, I don't know your prices here. I just wrote down the prices in euro. I hope you can convert it. In Germany, it starts with 20 euro for the cheapest routers. You can't do anything but installing the Freifunk firmware and let it work. There's nothing more to do on those routers. And it goes up to 120 euros for directed or directed antennas or the routers with directed antennas. So you are free to choose, and I guess you can spend a lot of more money for hardware if you want. So what kind of Wi-Fi do we use? I already told we use ad hoc mode, but that's not true so much anymore. Because ad hoc mode isn't, it lacks driver support by the hardware vendors. It started some years ago that normal laptops or your telephones couldn't use this normal ad hoc mode anymore. Or it wasn't accessible by the users. But there's another one, the 11S standard. It's a real standard and supported by a lot of platforms. And more communities move over to this mode, to use this mode, because it's more reliable than the ad hoc mode. The OpenWRT developers did a lot of work to make ad hoc mode available to other hardware, but it was really difficult because they had to do reverse engineering or talking to the vendors to get information about the hardware and so on. I hope with the new standard Ray, we will be successful and it will work. It's hard to switch a whole network when you have a network of hundreds of nodes. You have to tell every router to switch to the new standard because they can't talk to you anymore when you switch the network. And so we need to see how it can be done. I think a lot of communities do it via a scheduler and they say on day zero we will switch and every router knows when day zero is, and so it will be done in this way. And we also use 2.4 gigahertz and 5 gigahertz bands of Wi-Fi. It's 2.4 gigahertz is really difficult because it's very polluted, especially in big cities. This band is also used by other applications like Bluetooth or some video transmission systems. And you only have three channels that don't overlap in this area. In 5 gigahertz networks, you have a lot of channels and they don't overlap and you can use it much better. But if you want to use it outdoors, you have another constraint. It's the weather radar, because they also use some parts of the 5 gigahertz frequencies. And if you see strange clouds on your weather screen, you, maybe that has been done by Wi-Fi, so it's forbidden to use it in these frequencies, and there is a thing called DFS, dynamic frequency shifting. When the router detects there is a weather radar working, he has to change the frequency of the network within seconds. So that's really difficult, especially for networks where you rely on that everyone speaks on the same channel. And but we are working on solutions for that. And this is also one reason why we use point-to-point connections and on our backbone networks and not the ad hoc network or the ad hoc mode, because of the dynamic frequency shifting. This is working really good in the master and client mode, but not in those other modes.
It's easier to negotiate between the two parties.
Exactly. Okay, our firmwares we use on the devices. You asked what devices we can use. They should be supported by OpenWRT or LEED. This is one constraint we have, because the Freifunk firmwares are developed on the basis of OpenWRT and LEED. LEED is, I don't know if you know it, LEED is just a fork of OpenWRT. They forked about 1.5 years ago because they wanted to be faster in development, and now they are trying to remerge both systems again, and at the end it will be named OpenWRT again. So hopefully everything will go fine, and at the end we will have a faster and better OpenWRT. What Freifunk developers do, they extend it by packages. It's just a collection of packages we need for Freifunk, so that there's network packages, some kind of web server on those boxes, and of course some own packages for the routing algorithms, for example, or for the configuration scripts or configuration wizards we use there. Some communities, not all communities, build their own firmware frameworks where they build images for all kinds of routers they want to support. And so users can download firmware images on the websites of the communities and just install it and use it. And hopefully everything is documented in a good way, so the users will not struggle on installation. Let's come to dynamic routing. We have two major routing algorithms there. It's OLSR and Batman. Fun fact, both algorithms are developed by the same persons because they thought we have to improve OLSR. OLSR is the first approach they made and developed. It's based on layer 3 networks, so every router with using an OLSR routing algorithm has its own network configuration or its own IP configuration, announces its own IP networks, and OLSR routers always know the whole topology of the network. They know every router, how to get there and how expensive it is to get there and so on. OLSR, by the way, stands for optimized link state routing. Optimized link state routing, yeah, and it ends up in a more complex network configuration because you have to configure IP addresses for the routers, and you have to manage them. You don't want duplicate IP addresses in your Freifunk network because this leads to errors you can't fix or you can't find or you can hardly find. This is the disadvantage of this protocol. And of course, some when the networks becomes too big, maybe in, it's also too big for the routers to know every other router and every other route. But at the moment we don't have these problems, but communities using OLSR aren't that big, I guess. The other one, it's also developed by Electra. She did the first one, OLSR, and she also developed a lot of Wi-Fi stuff. Batman stands for Better Approach to Mobile Ad Hoc Networking. And this is a layer base, a layer 2 based network. It's like a bit big switch, all routers that are in ad hoc mode connect to each other and can just route directly to the next router they want to access. The configuration is easier at this point because a lot of communities just use IPv6 auto configuration, and so you don't have to manage IP addresses. You have a question?
For those of us who haven't been working on it with networks for a long time, please remind me or us about layer 3 and layer 2.
Okay, the layer 2 network is basically the connection where you see the MAC addresses of all the other devices in your network, while on layer 3, I'm not a layer expert too, and the layer 3 network you extended by, for example, by the IP addresses. So you have configured IP addresses in layer 3 networks, and in layer 2, you only have the MAC addresses to contact each other. One disadvantage at this point or on Batman is you have a lot of multicast traffic when the network grows too big. At the beginning, it was developed for networks of, for example, 20 routers, and everything was okay. Then communities came and grew up a lot, and then they had 100, 200 routers. This worked out too, but on small DSL lines, you had problems. You couldn't use your bandwidth for internet anymore because of the multicast traffic when they are talking via VPN to other Batman routers. The communities started to split their networks in different multicast domains so they could reduce this traffic. This problem was not that big anymore. What we do in Berlin, we combine both approaches. We have for the big network, we use OLSR connections, and when you have a local network or a local point, for example, a building like this one, you build just a Batman cloud in this building. And the advantage is within this layer 2 network, you just can work around and you never lose the connection because it's a layer 2 connection. And you get roaming out of the box or handovers out of the box within these networks. And in OLSR networks, when you get to a new router, you need a new IP configuration. This means you need to have a new DHCP request, and normally you lose your connection to the internet. For example, when you hear a radio stream or something like this.
New question.
Yeah.
Have you been working a lot on IPv6?
Personally, I didn't work so much with IPv6. Some communities did it. They provide public IPv6 addresses, but I don't think they provide public IPv6 to the devices at the end.
I was just wondering about how this would work with roaming on. There's a special protocol in IPv6 for roaming there.
Yes, there are also some people researching about this topic, for example, if you have different internet connections, because you have router one is there and router two is there, and both have an internet connection with a different upstream provider, how do you get your answer back at the end? This is a problem too, where people are researching on. And here's a link. 2 years ago, Elektra and Thomas, who maintained OLSR long time, they just had a nice, really nice and entertaining talk about the history of both routing protocols and algorithms. If you like, you can take a look on it. So what firmware tools do we use? Of course, we don't want to configure everything via Telnet or SSH anymore, and users don't want to do it anymore because a lot of users unfortunately don't know about it. So there are several web interfaces for OpenWRT. One example is the Lucy web interface. It's UCI is the United Configuration Interface or something like that. UCI files are the base of the configuration on OpenWRT routers. And we can take a look on how it looks like. This is just this is my router in still in Weimar, and for example we have on this router in Weimar we use still OLSR connections or OLSR networks, and here you can see the neighbors table of our network there, and this router has four neighbors. One is a fake neighbor, is just this is a VPN server to connect with other mesh clouds, and here you can get just some information on the routers. We also have services that are announced on the network via OLSR. You can also announce services if you provide a service in your network, just write it into a file. There's no interface, unfortunately, and the service will be shown on every router's status page. There should also be a map. I don't know if it works anymore because it's based on Microsoft Bing, I guess. Doesn't seem so. And very important, we do have a contact page on our routers. So if you have a problem with the network, or you identify a problem with the network, or just want to give a beer to your neighbor, you can get in touch with him here. And this is the social component of Freifunk, to get in touch with your neighbors or with other people on community meetings, for example. What's also being used is the Meshkit. This is just an interface to build firmware images, pre-configured firmware images, where you can choose a community. It doesn't work for so much communities because the communities need to be involved into that. I'll take community Leipzig, for example. But it's also a bit difficult. You have to choose a target and so on. It's not that easy for users to just go there, build your image and be lucky. And then you can configure your router with this interface. OpenWRT provides a tool named Image Builder, where you pre-compile everything you need for OpenWRT, and OpenWRT is like any other Linux distribution. It's package-based, and this image builder just takes the packages you need, some extra files, and builds the image out of that. And so it's possible to just create individual images with this. You can set your password. You select the hardware you want to use. Give a host name, and for example, you can give the location of your router. The location is also very important in Freifunk networks, just to see it on the map later. And for example, if you are new and you wonder, is there someone close to my house? Can we connect with each other? You just go to the map of the community and can find if there is someone near you. And here, for example, is the Wi-Fi configuration where you can add some stuff for Wi-Fi. I think there was also an expert mode. And there you can do a lot of more. You can select a web interface that should be installed. And you can configure everything, LAN, wireless, WAN. And also you can also add some more packages to your image if you want. But I don't know if this is really used by users or if they just use the normal mode, because I think it's complicated enough to use it in normal mode than in expert mode. In Berlin, we're at the moment developing a new approach of configuration interface. This is our new kind of Freifunk configuration and configuration wizard. If we go here, we can just choose a model. If we aren't connected to a router, it's a single page application, and if you are connected to a router, this will be detected automatically. And even if you already had a I can switch it to English, so you maybe this is a feature too. And we tried to reduce the technical stuff, because it's also difficult to build interfaces to build generic interfaces for routers that are so different. Some routers have two Wi-Fi interfaces, some routers have five LAN ports, others have only one, and so on. And so we just tried to reduce the technical stuff and add the information we need. Here's just the map thing, and if you want to share your internet, the only thing you have to do in Berlin is the most technical thing to do is to enter your IP addresses you retrieved from a configuration portal we use there. But this is still in heavy development, so unfortunately it's not in production right now, but we are working on it to get it better. And what is used by other communities is Gluon. This is a firmware build framework, and they build really generic images, and you just need another configuration file where you fill in. But this can be done by, this shouldn't be done by the end users. This can be done by community members, where you enter your common SSID, your common locations or community settings, like community name and so on. And so you can have a kind of zero-conf approach for the end users. Just give them a file for a router. They also use the Batman network, so they don't need any IP address configuration on those routers. But it makes it necessary to have some central infrastructure, for example, DNS servers, DHCP servers, and so on, to provide the normal IPv4 internet access. If the world would consist of IPv6 only, I think it would work better without these configuration issues. Okay, I talked a lot about VPN. Sometimes I think VPN is really useful, for example, to connect mesh clouds with each other. So if you have a city and you have no total connection of all routers or not enough routers in between, there will be mesh clouds that will never see each other. So we use VPN servers just to connect via routers via the internet, and you have a virtual Freifunk network for the whole city or area where you want to be connected. We also used VPN solutions to prevent users from the liability problems. This was the thing we introduced in 2012. Hopefully we can reduce those VPN servers, because they are also very... we need a lot of VPN servers of this kind because of the traffic you get when you have all the internet traffic on this servers. And we have the intercity VPN. This one is used to connect Freifunk communities with each other. So you have community in Berlin, you have the community in Leipzig, and if you connect them via intercity VPN, we can use the services the Leipzig community provides in Berlin and vice versa.
Munich, and they were talking something about the total bandwidth or out of the network. I suppose Berlin is perhaps the biggest?
Nope.
Okay, but anyway, yeah. Do you have any idea about how much bandwidth we're talking about in and out of the biggest network, the Berlin network?
We're 20 terabytes in both directions per month. So it's really a lot of traffic you need. We got a lot of traffic sponsored in Berlin, and also other communities got traffic sponsored, because otherwise you couldn't pay for it. If you had to pay for so much traffic, this wouldn't be affordable, and you can't do it with donations. Yes. What VPN tunnels do we use for these connections? Mostly we use OpenVPN, Fasti, or VTune to connect mesh clouds and to prevent from liability problems. And for intercity VPN, there's BGP used. So we play internet and connect networks of networks. Okay, the next one, maps. Maps is a big topic in Freifunk, because everyone says I can make a better map than before. it's a kind of history. It's as long as Freifunk exists, the map discussions exist. We are going on with this, and I think we have very good maps. Because of this things. For example, this is called Freifunkkarte, and this is what someone asked before. Here you can see all the Wi-Fi routers in Germany. So if you go deeper in here, you can see at the end the routers there, get some basic information on it. And all this data of this map is collected by the Freifunk API. So they just go to the API files of the communities, get the map URLs from these communities, and mix all together. And at the end, they build this wonderful map. So I guess we can see a nice statistic. You can see the growth of the number of routers in Germany. It started, the map project started in 2015 when we had about 10,000 routers, and now we are at about 46,000 here. Sometimes some services aren't available, so the total number of routers will go down, but this is just statistics. So, but you also can see the times of very strong growth are over now, because there is already so much done in Freifunk networks, so everything goes a bit slower now. Okay, what do we have? We also have the open Wi-Fi map. This is another example for a map. It was developed some years ago, and if we go in here, we can see some more information. I have to find my orientation here. I want to go to Berlin. Yeah, Berlin is a very nice effect of this map. There are so many nodes on a small room. You have to zoom in very close to see some connections, but now we can see it.
There's yours?
I'm not sure if mine is here on this map. But just let us take a look on this one. I don't know if you know the Teufelsberg in Berlin. It has been used by CIA or some other agencies in the Cold War for radio stations there. Now we use it for radio stations too. And here you can get some basic information. Often, if the people don't give any information on their routers, you won't see so much. And it also depends on the firmware installed. Some firmwares give more information to this map than other firmwares. But you can also see, if you click on the connection, you can get very interesting information about this connection, about the quality from both seen from both sides, and about the distance. The distance, of course, is only given by the locations the routers give. So it's not a real measurement of the distance, because I don't know if it's possible to do such a measurement, but I just wanted to find this real long connections. Here you can see this is one of our big steeples where we have so much connections to other routers and other high buildings and so on. And this is, for example, part of the Berlin backbone. So maybe I guess when I get out one more, no.
It drops into a grid at a certain scale.
But here you can see this is the backbone ring in Berlin, where it's just built on high buildings. So the ring is now closed, and this is was really a big project for several years. You do have a question?
Yes, you showed us two different maps, but do they use the same data set?
No. This map is just smaller. It's mainly used by the Berlin community and by some other communities. The other map is based on the maps other communities give to the Freifunk API. So they use also different map solutions. So it's difficult to say if there is a map that shows, for example, shows all the routers or something like that. But I also have another map solution I can show you. This is the map of Freifunk Hamburg. They use a map called Mesh Viewer. This is developed and often used by communities that use the Batman algorithm, because they just use the information that you can get out there. It's called Mesh Viewer. And here you can also see information about routers. They have some statistics, how many clients are connected to the routers, for example. You can see the neighbor nodes of those routers, and of course a lot of hardware information on these. Even how many RAM is free. Okay, and there's also another node. So here you can see it's just a topology view. It's not a geographical view of nodes. But sometimes this helps to have this kind of view, just to see where are connections, where are mesh clouds, and where can we improve something. And these red dots you see here are connected clients to these nodes.
Wow, that green thing on the right is quite green.
Yeah. Ah, this is a church. It's I guess, and. But I'm not sure. We should ask the people in Hamburg what it means. But it seems there are a lot of routers on a very close space, and every router is connected with the other router, and you have a perfect count of connections. Okay. And what another guy in Berlin has built is very interesting too. He built a tool. I don't have the tool available because you need to install Google Earth. But he managed to get a line of sight tool, so you can go to a possible location and see where can I get a connection to what routers and. This is a really interesting project, and in our wiki it is described how it works, and so if anyone may or want to use it, just read this wiki page and you can use this tool. And I guess there are a lot of other map solutions in the Freifunk universe I didn't show here because I don't know them all. Okay, what else do we do? We also provide services. We try to convince people to provide services within the Freifunk network, because Freifunk should be more than internet, and we can learn about the services, and we can have more privacy and independence from commercial providers, for example. Some people in Hamburg provide their own kind of Dropbox replacement, where you can just share your files, and they say we don't save anything about you except your files and your username and so on. And this is what we are doing this for. Other people have weather stations on their routers, so they can distribute weather information on the network, and everyone else can use it. There are also projects about sensor networks do some measurements. There is this LoRaWAN project where some people work with, and for example, one community used it to just measure the temperature of a sea to see if they can go to bath or not. And this is just a thing you can really do good with Freifunk networks, or some other measurements we want to do about the air pollution and so on. And it's easy to connect a router with some of this hardware that makes the measurements and distribute it all over the town and collect the information on a central point. I also told before that people are researching on things and we get support by the Google Summer of Code. Freifunk acts as an umbrella organization there. We are part of Google Summer of Code since 2009, and in this year we had 15 students projects. It was really a lot of student projects. And we act as an umbrella organization for a lot of other wireless communities, for example, the Linux in Italia, GUIFINET in Spain, all the communities we are connected with. And of course, OpenWRT also has some projects because we want some things to get developed or just done. Yes.
So you have 15 projects.
How many students are involved?
15 students.
It's, four projects this
year. Yeah, exactly. And 15 students is really a lot. Even if I only was an administrator of the admin of.
I deliberately put it where more people agree.
Okay, so. If you see any, if you have some wireless problems next year and you need something developed, you are invited to be part of the Google Summer of Code 2. If we get accepted as organization, it's not so easy to get it. But if you have some ideas, I think I'll write by the end of the year emails again to collect ideas for the next Google Summer of Code, and we can add it to our wiki page. Okay, and as I heard, you plan to reboot or restart your community here. Maybe as conclusion, some words. I think the most important thing is to find people, not only developers, also some people that can do some text work or talk to people or designers, web developers. It's not only about hardware and hacking. It's much more Freifunk. You could also develop a new map solution, for example. Have a communication platform. Create a website. Be present on social media so people can find you. Have a mailing list or something you prefer. In Germany, we also have some people that prefer forums and they use that. I prefer mailing lists. So just have this communication platform, do regular meetings. I think this is the most important, to have one time weekly or bi-weekly meetings where people can come and show up and you can talk about what to do next and help people flash their routers with the firmware and so on. You can also offer some special events, meetups for example, or have a hackathon if you want to get things done in a fast way. Just do one or two hackathons for some topics and yes, of course, visit other communities, use their experiences, how to build networks. If you are in Germany, just look if there's a Freifunk community nearby. If you're in Berlin, give me a call and we can meet at the Freifunk meeting in Berlin. It's a weekly meeting on Wednesday. And of course, transfer knowledge, just spread the knowledge over the world so people can use it and play around and have fun with their devices. Okay, I just collected some links here. I think I will send you the presentation as a PDF at the end, and then you can send it around and click on all the links I put in there. My contact data is also in the slides, and this is my last slide.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have a few questions. I'll just see how far we'll take this. One thing I've noticed in the Serval project, are you aware of the Serval project? It's a mesh project focusing on cell phones. And their expressed goal is to be able to communicate telephone calls, SMSs, even if there are no base stations around. And they are trying to use normal phones. I think they have to use rooted Android phones because ad hoc network is not implemented in Android. One of the key features there is that all communication is encrypted. And they are using kind of IPv6 addresses, where the IPv6 address is the public key of the telephone. So if you know the address, you also know the key, so you can communicate encrypted. The question I'm trying to raise is how can you make sure that the Freifunk network work even with no base stations? Can you do something like the Serval network is doing? Can you do telephone calls? Can you make SMSs? And can you make sure it works even in a mine or in a subway?
If you, yes, it will work without internet access, of course, because of the ad hoc networking thing, and you can communicate with each other, but you, of course, you need the software to do it. There's another project, I can open that up. Oh, do I have internet? This one, I mean, they built a software you can install on your laptop, on your mobile phone, and on OpenWRT routers, and they also include some kind of apps, for example, messaging app, voice over IP app, and all the devices do mesh with each other. So if you install it on your laptop and I install it on my laptop, this software will enable the ad hoc mode on this network on both laptops. And at the end, they use OLSR as the routing algorithm. So we have a connection with each other and we can send us messages if we can see each other. Of course, you need a Wi-Fi connection to at least to a neighbor and a neighbor, so we have some connection over the mesh network. So it won't work if there is a disruption in this within this connection, then it can't work.
Another idea we have floated in the Norwegian community is to make wireless routers, mesh nodes that are road lights. Because if you are able to provide road lights, you can actually sell road lights to people that want to buy road lights with integrated mesh node. Then you get power, you get height, and you get distribution. And you actually get paid to set up the node. Did you consider doing things like that in Freifunk?
No, not right now, but I think this sounds interesting, of course.
And when you see what they are willing to pay, like the local area where I live, it's a private area, so we have to pay for our own lighting. Mm. And the prices for one light is amazing.
Yeah.
Including mounting, of course. We pay for someone to put up the lights and make sure they work, but still, you could add a mesh node there for a fraction of the price.
Someone tried to do it, but it's not easy to convince the city administration to let someone else install anything there. There was years before there was a suggestion by the Pirate Party, I guess, to install Wi-Fi routers on every traffic light. And this wasn't even possible to to realize. Yeah, but sounds is interesting, of course, and yeah.
That could just be that the political authorities didn't want to give the a rival party a victory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
maybe yes.
They found a very good excuse that wasn't lacked, of
yeah.
course, but.
And another thing, you mentioned that ad hoc network is not working very well with a lot of vendors. A few years ago, I looked at the 802.11s, and it wasn't working very well with the vendors either. Is it really...
This improved very, very much. And we have a lot of communities in Germany that they use the 11s thing now. And
is it working with any cell phones?
I'm not sure, because all the communities drive their Wi-Fi routers with two modes. They provide this ad hoc mode and an access point mode, so people with their cell phones can connect to the Freifunk network. So your cell phone or your laptop typically isn't part of the mesh network. It's just a client on an access point network there.
But isn't the obvious solution if you want to have roaming on your cell phone to get it on the mesh network?
Works with that, because they install OLSR even on your computer, and then it works out of the box because you don't need a new IP configuration on every router you see. Yes.
Yeah, I think we're done, aren't we?
Yeah.
Thank you.
See you, we're going.